Let's talk about email.
Yeah, that's right. I wrote a book.
you wrote yet another amazing book, A World Without Email. Maybe one way to enter this discussion is to ask, what is the hyperactive hive mind, which is the concept you open the book with?
Yeah, and the devil. it's the scourge of hundreds of millions. So I called this book A World Without Email. The real title should be A World Without the Hyperactive Hive Mind Workflow, but my publisher didn't like that.
Yeah. Right?
So we had to get a little bit more pithy. I was trying to answer the question after deep work, why is it so hard to do this? Like, if this is so valuable, if we can produce much higher, if people are much happier, why do we check email a day? Why are we on Slack all day?
Yeah.
You know? And so I started working on this book immediately after deep work. And so my initial interviews were done in 2016. So it took 5 years to pull the threads together. But I was trying to understand, why is it so hard for most people to actually find any time to do the stuff that actually moves the needle? And the story was, and I thought this was, I hadn't heard this reported anywhere else. That's why it took me so long to pull it together, is email arrives on the scene. Email spreads. I trace it. It really picks up steam in the early 1990s. Between like 1990 and 1995, it makes its move, right? Mm-hmm. And it does so for very pragmatic reasons. It was replacing existing communication technologies that it was better than. It was mainly the fax machine, voicemail, and memos, right? So this was just better, right? So it was a killer app because it was useful. In its wake came a new way of collaborating, and that's the hyperactive hive mind. So it's the like the virus that follows the rats that went through Western Europe for the Black Plague. As email spread through organizations, in its wake came the hyperactive hive mind workflow, which says, okay, guys, here's the way we're going to collaborate. We'll just work things out on the fly with unscheduled back and forth messages. Just boom, boom, boom. Let's go back and forth. Hey, what about this? Did you see this? What about that client? What's going on over here? That followed email. It completely took over office work. And the need to keep up with all of these asynchronous back and forth unscheduled messages, as those got more and more and more, and we had more of those to service, the need to service those required us to check more and more and more and more, mm-hmm. right? And so by the time, and I go through the numbers, but by the time you get to today, now the average knowledge worker has to check one of these channels once every 6 minutes. Because every single thing you do in your organization, how you talk to your colleagues, how you talk to your vendors, how you talk to your clients, how you talk to the HR department, it's all this asynchronous unscheduled back and forth messaging. And you have to service the conversations. And it spiraled out of control, and it has sort of devolved a lot of work in the office now to all I do is constantly tend communication channels.
So it's fascinating what you're describing is nobody ever paused in this whole evolution to try to create a system that actually works. That it was kind of like a huge fan of cellular automata. So it just kind of started
a very
simple mechanism, just like cellular automata. It just kind of grew to overtake all the fundamental communication of how we do business and also personal life.
Yeah. And that's one of the big ideas is that the unintentionality.
Yeah.
Right. So this goes back to technological determinism. I mean, this is a weird business book because I go deep on philosophy. I go deep on, for some reason, we get into paleoanthropology for a while. We do a lot of neuroscience. It's kind of a weird book. But I got real into this technological determinism, right? This notion that just the presence of a technology can change how people act. That's my big argument about what happened with the hive mind. And I can document specific examples, right? So I document this example in IBM, 1987, maybe 85, but it's in like the mid to late 80s, IBM, our Monk headquarters. We're going to put in internal email, right? Because it's convenient. And so they ran a whole study. And so I talked to the engineer who ran this study, Adrian Stone. Like, we're going to run this study to figure out how much do we communicate, because it was still an era where it's expensive, right? So you have to provision a mainframe. So you can't over-provision. Like, we want to know how much communication actually happens. So they went and figured it out. How many memos, how many calls, how many notes. Great. We'll provision a mainframe to handle email that can handle all of that. So if all of our communication moves to email, the mainframe will still be fine. In 3 days, they had melted it down. People were communicating 6 times more than that estimate. So just in 3 days, the presence of a low-friction digital communication tool drastically changed how everyone collaborated. So that's not enough time for, you know, an all-hands meeting. Guys, we figured it out. You know, this is what we need to communicate a lot more. This is what's going to make us more productive. We need more emails. It's emergent.
Isn't that just on the positive end amazing to you? Like, isn't email amazing? Like in those early days,
yeah.
Like just the frictionless communication. I mean, email is awesome. Like, the people say that there's a lot of problems with emails, just like people say a lot of problems with Twitter and so on. It's kind of cool that you can just send a little note.
It was a miracle, right? Yeah. So I wrote a, there's originally was a New Yorker piece from a year or two ago called Was Email a Mistake? And then it's in the book too.
Yeah.
But I go into the history of email, like why did it come along? And it solved a huge problem. So it was the problem of fast asynchronous communication.
Yeah.
And it was a problem that did not exist until we got large offices. When we got large offices, synchronous communication, like let's get on the phone at the same time. There's too much overhead to it. There's too many people you might have to talk to. Asynchronous communication, like let me send you a memo when I'm ready and you can read it when you're ready, took too long. Mm-hmm. And so it was like a huge problem. So one of the things I talked about is the way that when they built the CIA headquarters, there was such a need for fast asynchronous communication that they built a pneumatic powered email system. They had these pneumatic tubes all throughout the headquarters with electromagnetic routers. So you would put your message in a plexiglass tube and you would turn these brass dials about the location. You would stick it in these things and pneumatic tubes and it would shoot and sort and work its way through these tubes to show up in just a minute or something at the floor and at the general office suite where you wanted to go. And my point is the fact that they spent so much money to make that work show how important fast asynchronous communication was to large offices. So when email came along, it was a productivity silver bullet. It was a miracle. I talked to the researchers who were working on computer-supported collaboration in the late 80s, trying to figure out how are we going to use computer networks to be more productive, and they were building all these systems and tools. Email showed up. It just wiped all that research off the map. Mm-hmm. There was no need to build these custom intranet applications. There was no need to build these communication platforms. Email could just do everything.
Yeah.
Right? So it was a miracle application, which is why it spread everywhere. But it's one of these things where, okay, unintended consequences, right? You had this miracle productivity silver bullet. It spread everywhere, but it was so effective. It just, you know, I don't know, like a drug. I'm sure there's some pandemic metaphor here, analogy here of a drug that like is so effective at treating this that it also blows up your whole immune system and then everyone gets sick. But
well, ultimately, it probably significantly increased the productivity of the world, but there's a kind of hump that it now has plateaued. And then the fundamental question you're asking is like, okay, how do we take the next, how do we keep increasing the productivity?
Yeah, I think it brought it down. So my contention, and so I get into this a little bit in the book, but I have a more recent Wired article that put some newer numbers to this. I subscribe to the hypothesis that the hyperactive hive mind was so detrimental. So yeah, it helped productivity at first, right? When you could do fast asynchronous communication, but very quickly, there was a sort of exponential rise in communication amounts. Mm-hmm. Once we got to the point where the hive mind meant you had to constantly check your email, I think that made us so unproductive that it actually was pulling down non-industrial productivity. And I think the only reason why, so it certainly has not been going up. That metric's been stagnating for a long time now while all of this was going on. I think the only reason why it hasn't fallen is that we added these extra shifts off the books. Mm-hmm. Like I'm going to work for 3 hours in the morning. I'm going to work for 3 hours at night. And only that, I think, has allowed us to basically maintained a stagnated non-industrial growth. We should have been shooting up the charts. I mean, this is miraculous innovations, computer networks. And then we built out these $100 billion ubiquitous worldwide high-speed wireless internet infrastructure with supercomputers in our pockets where we could talk to anyone at any time. Like, why did our productivity not shoot off the charts? Because our brain can't context switch once every 6 minutes.
So it's fundamentally back to the context switching. Context switching is poison. It's the... What is it about email that forces context switching? Is it both our psychology that drags us in,
or is it
the expectation of?
Yeah, right. Because it's not, I think we've seen this through a personal will or failure lens recently. Like, yes. Oh, am I addicted to email?
Yes.
I have bad etiquette about my email. No, it's the underlying workflow. So the tool itself, I will exonerate, right? I think I would rather use POP3 than a fax protocol, right? I think it's easier. The issue is the hyperactive hive mind workflow. So if I am now collaborating with 20 or 30 different people with back and forth unscheduled messaging, I have to tend those conversations, right? It's like you have 30 metaphorical ping pong tables. And when the balls come back across, you have to pretty soon hit it back or stuff actually grinds to a halt. Mm-hmm. So it's the workflow that's the problem. It's not the tool. It's the fact that we use it to do all of our collaboration. Let's just send messages back and forth, which means you can't be far from checking that. Because if you take a break, if you batch, if you try to have better habits, it's going to slow things down.